Ladies and gentlemen, Shelley Buckler.
Thank you. Good evening, and welcome to this special tribute to Dr. Edwin H. Land. Through personal reflections, some of the people who knew Dr. Land best will share their memories of him as a leader, a scientist, inventor, teacher, and a visionary. Dr. Land was all of that and more, an extraordinary, vibrant human being. He was warm, sensitive, caring, and a friend. For those of you who may not be aware of it, he had a nickname, which he liked to be called when among friends. So if you hear people calling him Din tonight, you'll understand. This evening, Dr. Land, Din, is among friends. Now, you've heard the expression that the next speaker needs no introduction. That is certainly true for Mack Booth, our president and CEO, in this auditorium. But in addition to his normal presidential duties, Mack has a special role in Polaroid, and that is keeping strong the essential values that Dr. Land nurtured in all of us. To value the process of creating, because it is a process that enriches and promotes our individual growth as it builds material values for us and for our customers, as he leads the company into and through the 90s. The world today is a far different place from the world of Dr. Land's early days with Polaroid. But the company's core values remain the same, thanks to Mack. And now, ladies and gentlemen, I'm very pleased to introduce Mack Booth.
Thank you, Shelley. I know that you and I, and along with all of our team of colleagues in the company, will make sure we keep those values and principles alive and growing for many generations to come. I want to thank all of you for coming here this evening and joining with us in this tribute to Dr. Land. When I heard that more than 6,000 people were going to be joining us today, a Saturday evening, a beautiful September day, I was again struck by the power and the meaning of the words, the Polaroid family. All of us, and literally millions and millions of people around the world, recognize Dr. Land's technical and inventive genius. But only a few of us, those of us who've been part of this Polaroid family, have had the opportunity to understand and experience the inspirational, the caring, the humorous, the organizational genius side of Dr. Land. I believe it is only us and his family who fully appreciate the breadth of what he has contributed to our society. I know I don't think about the totality of his contributions often enough. But when I do, like tonight, I'm overwhelmed by my feeling of good fortune that I've had to have known him, to have worked with him, and to be a member of his industrial family. Today, we're honoring a man who has meant so much to this company and to every one of us in this room tonight. A man who instituted the values that made this company have humanity, created an environment that attracted creative people from all over the world, and once they came here and began working, he encouraged them to stretch their minds and build on that creativity. A man who encouraged the fully rewarding work life for every Polaroid employee. A man of enormous imagination, and yet the discipline to focus himself and all of us, as we all remember, on those special, dedicated, singular efforts that he was interested in. A man who's meant so much to the world at large. A man whose contributions in so many fields, photography, optics, and national defense, just to name a few, added to the lives of people everywhere in the world. A man who led us, inspired us, and allowed us to be the family that we are. I want to again thank you for coming here this evening and joining with us, and I hope you enjoy the program.
Dr. Land was a world-renowned scientist, and few know more about his accomplishments than our next guest. Dr. Elkin Blout worked closely with Dr. Land for 19 years as a member of the company, as an officer, and for the next 29 years, up to the very present moment, as a good friend and consultant to the company and to many of us. He is currently a professor emeritus at Harvard Medical School and is treasurer of the National Academy of Sciences. Last year, Dr. Blout was awarded the National Medal of Science by President Bush. This caps a most distinguished career as professor of biochemistry at Harvard, doing basic research in protein chemistry, dean at the School of Public Health, and a recipient of numerous awards. That's the scientific side of Elkin. But I'd like to tell you a little story about Elkin and Din. Years ago, Din collected cars. Every so often, he bought a Buick or an Olds or a station wagon or a Jeep or a Land Rover or whatever, but he never sold any of them. So he had a barn on Brattle Street that was filled with cars. And there was one that Elkin really liked. It was a big Olds convertible, which he offered to buy from Din on several occasions. Din always refused to sell. He was somehow attached to these cars. But one day he called Elkin and he said, "If you still want the car, come on down and bring your check." Elkin rushed down to Din's office before he changed his mind, handed him the check, and he said, "Where's the car?" And Din said, "It's in Central Square where it broke down this morning." Ladies and gentlemen, our friend, Dr. Elkin Blout.
Thank you. That's a true story. I do like convertibles. I've always liked them. And having this beautiful monster, an Olds 98 convertible, parked next to me every day, gave me great opportunity to talk to Din about it, and he finally gave in the way you heard. Well, when I begin to think about how it began, how I came to Polaroid in 1943, I still find it amazing. I had just finished a fellowship at Harvard and had accepted another position in Philadelphia. I was at my farewell party with some colleagues, one of whom was the late Professor Robert Woodward. He was supposed to be there, and he happened to be delayed. When he arrived, he explained that he had just met a very interesting man, the founder of Polaroid, and you know who that is, who didn't want their conversation to end, and that is typical of Din. Trying to excuse himself, Bob ended up telling him about the party and about me, and he said, "Dr. Land," and when he arrived, he said Dr. Land wanted to meet me. I met with Din the next day at that wonderful old building at 730 Main Street. And as it turned out, Din made me a job offer I couldn't refuse. That offer resulted in a long and, I think, very fruitful association with Polaroid, which is how I happened to be here tonight talking to you. I knew Din from two different perspectives. First, during these years as a Polaroid employee, and those were exciting years. And then for the last 25 years, as a scientist at Harvard and in Washington. But the same picture of him emerges from each of these perspectives. I see Din as one of the most inventive people I have ever known. He had intense desire to do new things and to do old things in a new way. In fact, it was more than a desire, it was really a need. Din once told a London cab driver that he was an addict. The cab driver looked around at him and nearly let him out at the next corner until Din smiled and said, he was an addict for scientific research. I have to have my shot of research every day. I have to do an experiment every day or I suffer. And that's true. That's the way and that instant photography was developed. It was really exciting for him to be able to do experiments on the process very quickly, in a few hours, and see the results. Then it became not a few hours, 2 hours. Then it became 30 minutes. He was a very impatient man, and he loved his work. Din's invention of instant photography is the one, of course, for which he's most famous. But scientists in the world outside this room view him in a much broader context. His invention of synthetic polarizers, which he patented when he was in his teens in 1933, initiated the field of polarized light as an applied science. And many of us have seen the fruits of this work in the polarizing headlights, the polarizing glasses, and some of the work with polarizing headlights that we remember well. During World War II, Din's research teams developed, and they were at Polaroid, new weapons and new war materials. And he was consultant to the top committee of the defense effort, the National Defense Research Committee. After the war, as a member of the President's Science Advisory Committee, he was one of the people responsible for the development of a very famous vehicle, the high-altitude U-2 aircraft, and the subsequent development of satellite surveillance. I tell you this because Din was not a person who was focused only in one field, in one area, as many scientists are, but he was able to expand his horizons and enjoyed doing it. Din was an advisor to several presidents and the recipient of so many honorary degrees and awards, I couldn't possibly recount them all to you tonight. But one of the first awards he received, and which he treasured highly, was the Rumford Medal of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. He received this in 1945 for basic research in optics. The field of optics continued to fascinate him for the rest of his life. No one understood at that time, and few people do today, how the eye and brain perceive color. But Din was determined to shed new light on this problem. From about 1960 on, he worked on color vision, and he traveled all over the country, and in fact to Europe, to lecture on his findings. And he had great audiences. They appreciated what he was saying and the way he was saying it. Speaking of travel, reminds me of a story I'd like to share with you about another side of Din. As hard as he worked, and we all know how hard that was, there was a very playful side to him. Back in the 50s, Bill McCune, Howie Rogers, Din, and I used to travel every 2 months to a town in New York called Rochester to meet with Eastman Kodak. We were developing the color film at that time. And I remember Din and Bill having contests with each other at night. After the meetings, we were sort of tense, and they would get over their tenseness by jumping over the beds in the hotel room. It was really, I didn't participate in this, but Din did. Din was a very competitive person, as I gather you understand. But I'm afraid that Bill McCune was more athletic, and he usually won. Fortunately for all of us, Din's competitive spirit met with much greater success in the scientific area. Din was not only competitive, but was also one of the most inventive people the world has ever known. He has over 500 patents issued in the United States in his name. In fact, he is credited with more inventions than anyone except Thomas Edison. It's interesting when you think about it to realize that both of them worked with light and optics as a medium. And like Edison, Din illuminated the world of science in ways that we all appreciate now. Like Edison, he used the brilliance of his mind for the pleasure and good of all of mankind. And like Edison, he left a legacy that changed the world forever. This evening, you'll be hearing a lot about the many different facets of Din Land, his leadership as an executive, his courage and daring as an entrepreneur, his inspiration as a man of great vision. But let us not forget, first and foremost, that he was one of the greatest scientific inventors of all time. To him, Polaroid was a living experiment, and was an experiment that succeeded beyond any dreams. I think of him now as brilliant, impatient, forceful, a true genius, but most often as a friend. And as a friend, I miss him very much.
Thank you, Elkin. You know, working with Dr. Land was not only exciting and inspiring, it was enjoyable. He was very personable, and he had a wonderful wit. One time, I accompanied him to one of our development laboratories where silver coatings were done. He wanted certain experiments run, but the lab people had their own ideas of how the experiment should be conducted. The technical head of the group proceeded to deliver a polite little lecture to him on this subject of how the Land's experiment ought to really be run. He listened patiently for a while. Then he got up, and he started pacing up and down the room. Remember how he used to pace? You know? He started pacing up and down the room. Then finally he stopped. He looked at this fellow, and he said, "How many hours a week do you code here?" And the fellow replied, "Why, 40 hours. "Well," Din said, "I own 15% of this company. So I own 6 hours of coding out here. Do the experiment the way I told you to do it." And they did. I know our next two guests have stories of their own to tell. Nan Checker and Joan Angeroni worked very closely with Din for many years when they were with the company. Nan worked side by side with him in connection with the Kodak patent infringement suit, and they spent endless hours working with lawyers and attending court hearings from 1976 right up through the final decision. In fact, Nan was so involved with the case that she ended up going back to school and becoming a lawyer. Joe had another relationship with Din. He was the keeper of the secret ingredients. Din was intensely concerned about security, so he had materials shipped to his home, Cambridge, where they'd be hidden in his garage until Joe would come by, peel off the labels, glue code names on, put the stuff in his car, drive it to the Waltham factory. Back in the lab, he'd mix up secret concoctions and deliver them to the manufacturing floor. Now, Joe Angeroni did this for 26 of the 41 years that he spent at Polaroid, which means that he was probably involved in more secret operations than James Bond. So let's give both Nan and Joe a warm welcome.
I want to say hello to those of you who know me and those of you who don't. When I was asked to talk about my recollections of Dr. Land, I had about 41 years of wonderful stories to choose from. But I remember one trip in particular that I took with him back in the early days. He always liked to take lots of pictures wherever we went. It was good publicity for the company. One time in Ohio, he took a picture of a chambermaid in his hotel room. She was thrilled with it. About 5 minutes later, she came back with a friend, another chambermaid. Well, eventually we had about 7 chambermaids, these getting their pictures taken. Finally, Dr. Land said, "You know, you girls will probably get fired and I'll be in trouble." And they said, "Oh no, don't worry about it. Our boss is coming up next."
Dr. Land had a great sense of humor. I remember in December we used to have a little fake Christmas tree that would be set up in the back lab, and it would be decorated with chocolate Santa Clauses as ornaments about that high. Each one had a different name on it, and when people came into the lab to say Merry Christmas, they would be given their Santa Claus to take away, or they would take it. I must say that the one marked EHL was always snatched off very early on. But Dr. Land's sweet tooth was there, and all the other Santas were still hanging. He didn't want to deprive anybody of his or her own Santa, so he would just break off the legs and restructure the foil so they would look whole. But a lot of people got legless Santas.
Well, we tend to think we'll never forget some of these experiences, but as time passes, a lot of stories become lost to memory.
That's why, for some time now, the company has been working to preserve some of these memories by interviewing employees, former employees, and retirees, and creating a living history of Dr. Land and the Polaroid family. In fact, we're going to see a bit of a preview tonight. It's called Remembrances, and we hope you enjoy it.
These are the examples of the polarizing discs that were made for scientific kits.
This is a vectrograph, and it's a polarized image of right eye and left eye image of a piece of sculpture.
This is a ring sight, which Dr. Land has invented.
Land was basically an optimist. For him, really nothing was too hard and almost nothing was impossible.
I think he was so brilliant. And I was hoping that some of that genius would rub off onto me even, but, well, I wouldn't doubt that I helped.
Dr. Land could really, could really make you feel inadequate on almost any subject because he just had so much knowledge and remembered it all.
One thing I learned was that in doing research, he would ask me, did I try twice as much? So I finally learned how to ask myself those questions. Did I try twice as much?
I was hired to do everything that had to be done. We had no specific jobs. We were a group of people that just went from one little job to the other and got it done.
He called me on the phone from the fifth floor and said, "I'd like you to try an experiment." And that was to expose a negative onto a piece of photosensitive film, dip it into some developer, but immediately press it against a plain piece of paper. Let the two pieces of paper sit together and then peel them apart. And call me up as to what you see on the blank piece of paper, the non-photosensitive piece. So I did that, followed it very explicitly, and lo and behold, there was a beautiful picture. A bit faint, but it was a definite picture, so I called up. And Land came down to those 5 flights of stairs like lightning and was ecstatic. He was just thrilled, and then he started to laugh. that was the beginning of the instant camera.
Land and Rogers were the sort of inventors who would just plow ahead and find some way of making it work, because we really don't understand everything by any means at all.
I was working in his lab on alternative processes to the black and white process. And but one day I noticed there was an entry at the bottom of his list that said color. So I pointed to it and said, may I do that? And he said, sure. That's how I got the assignment.
Well, the fun part of it was whether you're going to get called in on Friday and see whether you still had a job or not. Those were not the most profitable years in the history of the corporation.
He even had an idea that wouldn't it be fun to make teams of various groups, and we could have projects over the weekend, so we could continue to have our fun during the weekend, and then in addition to the fun we were having at work.
We used to kind of dread that his getting a cold and having to stay home, because he was then free to think of experiments. And he used the telephone extensively.
And his phone call was a very simple one. He called and said, when are we going to fix the problem?
He would chase around the world. If he thought of something, that, or if he had heard there was some problem somewhere.
The Coast Guard took the salesperson out to find us in the ocean to tell Peter Winsberg that Dr. Land wanted to talk to him immediately.
I remember that. That was a ride.
And the thing that you would always hear, day in, day out, was peals of laughter. Somebody would have a funny story, or someone would make up something. It was excitement, it was energy, it was fun looking at things in so many different ways.
When we started doing the SX-70 camera, he said, oh, this is the camera that I wanted to make back in 1948.
Well, he wouldn't stop until he saw every little piece. And he would get so emotional about the smallest detail, you couldn't imagine that he would ever know anything about it. And yet he would.
And he had the uncanny ability to look at solutions to a problem orthogonally, to look at them from a different viewpoint than most people would.
Just constantly testing.
Yeah, and testing the opposite of what you believe.
In the labs, there were always dozens or hundreds of things going on that Land would kind of plant like seeds and then come back and harvest later to bring together in the new products.
He was kind of a Ulysses in science. I mean, it was the exhilaration of the journey that was as much fun as getting there.
I'm awful glad that I had the chance to be able to work for Dr. Land. That he was a real compassionate man that you felt was a friend, and you wanted to work to help him achieve what he was trying to finish. And I don't know, I worked there 37 years and enjoyed every minute of it, so very glad that I did work at Polaroid through the whole exciting buildup of all the different products, from the sepia to black and white to color. It was fun. I enjoyed it.
Well, he loved good food, and he liked the adventure of finding new restaurants.
We went down an alley, opened the screen door, and here we are in the kitchen of the Chinese restaurant. And he's waving everybody, and he's looking in the pots and pans. Turns out that he spent a good deal of his dining time at Chinese restaurants, and he got to know everybody very well. And that's where I learned to eat those great big black Chinese mushrooms.
Dr. Land was always on supposedly on some diet. So I would ask him how was his diet going, and he would always say, you know, Lou, I don't like you and Bill McEwen, because both of you always stay skinny, and I always have to worry about my weight. So I used to tease him a lot about that.
If I was working with him and it was over dinner, then I'd have my lamb chops and he'd have his lamb chops. But I would be taking notes while he was talking and eating, and I wouldn't get to my lamb chop really until he was done with his lamb chop. But when he was done with his lamb chop, he'd lean over, kind of like your brother at the dinner table, and say, if you're not done with that lamb chop, do you mind if I take the lamb chop? So I never get to eat my lamb chop anyhow.
And I'm in the dark room working and smelling the pizza and getting hungrier and hungrier. When I come out of the dark room, I went to the hot plate. The tinfoil was open and the pizza was gone. And I said, what the heck happened to my pizza? And I looked up and there's Dr. Land running to his office. The summer gun stole my pizza.
He probably had five different personalities, but he knew when to turn on all of the five, never all at once, so that he could go anyplace and just blend in.
I've told other people he was one of the best patent attorneys I ever met.
Land was a great believer that advertising was not just a tool for awareness, it was a tool to teach.
How the words were put together and how it was presented, he considered that part of the invention.
But he also had a great deal of appreciation for literature, for philosophy. He always liked the rhythmic and leering turn of a sentence. He a voracious reader and thinker, and obviously capable of articulating it rather well.
It was often my job to go to the boss with
bad news.
Bad news. Now, he was kind enough not to shoot the messenger, but it seemed to me as though it took me a long time to get through to him, and he never would come right back and say, yeah, that's a problem.
It was almost as though he encouraged people to do things that he didn't approve of, so long as what they did was okay in the end.
So I came over to his office, 7 o'clock at night. He said, Connie, prove yourself before I talk to you. I was shocked, again, boiling internally. He was sitting in his office on the telephone. I have a picture here which shows it. Within 1 minute, I took 10 pictures in the dark with sonar, and every single one was in focus. I laid him down on the desk in front of him, and as the prints came up, he looked at him, put down the receiver without saying goodbye to his counterpart, got up, shook my hand, and said, thank you. That was my day.
Dr. Land's legacy, in my view, is to continue teaching.
It's always the journey that mattered. And he continued that until these last days, obviously, with the Institute and so on.
It's a place that Dr. Land built so that he could have scientists come there to study pure science without being encumbered.
Working at the Roland Institute for Science is like going to heaven without dying for a scientist.
The man was a creative genius, but I think people were his pet project. I think that he really cared about that.
He walked over and said, Mary, would you do a waltz for us? And I said, oh my God. I don't know how I got onto the dance floor, but I did. And I done a waltz for Dr. Land. That was my most cherished memory.
Anyone who worked closely with him loved the guy. There was no question about it.
With regards from your fellow fishermen in the stormy seas of research. And it says, Din, Stan, and Howie.
There's my father, John Muller, and Robert Burns Woodward, and myself, and Edwin H. Land, who was best man at my wedding. I constantly remember the optimism, the drive, the initiative, all the wonderful things that that man had, and the warmth. So that I know I became a better person for that experience. It was a beautiful, beautiful time.
He taught me the importance of an experiment that is as distinct from somebody's opinion.
I think the thing I miss the most about Dr. Land is that although I learned a lot, I didn't use the opportunity that I had for almost 18 years to learn a quantum amount more.
It was always a special thrill to go into the lab where Dr. Land was, because I knew I would always learn something from an interaction with him, and I was never disappointed.
I miss the personal interaction. I used to see him sometimes almost daily, and there was a give and take with him that just was, I miss a great deal.
I recognize his genius. I recognize the fact that this was a truly unique individual, the likes of which we may not see for a long, long time. So I miss everything about him. I miss his sense of humor. I miss his intellect. I miss his warmth. I miss him. I truly miss him.
He's a big brother. He was my older brother. He was that much of a friend.
My son died after graduating from MIT. And Dr. Land asked Dr. Wiesner to think of something that would be appropriate. And so Dr. Wiesner and Dr. Land set up a fellowship that is still going on at MIT for five scholars at $5,000 apiece every year. And I think that is wonderful.
Really, how wonderful that is to see all those remembrances and hearing the stories of Dr. Land and seeing how diverse he was in so many areas. As we've just seen in this video, one of Dr. Land's priorities was education. He believed in fostering knowledge and motivating people to really achieve. To keep that value alive, the company is creating a living memorial by establishing a $1 million Edwin H. Land Endowment Fund to honor Dr. Land through a variety of awards and scholarships. Each year, three college scholarships will be given to children of employees at Polaroid who excel in mathematics and science. They will receive from $500 to $3,000 each year for 4 years. We will also be providing community scholarships for excellence in math and science in the 7 Massachusetts communities where Polaroid facilities are located. In addition, we'll be funding an innovation and learning grant, $25,000 to be awarded annually for a proposal addressing experimentation and the enhancement of learning. And we have also proposed to fund a joint scientific medal, which will be presented by the Optical and Imaging Societies. The recipient will be chosen by a distinguished group of scientists, and that recipient will receive a silver medal and a $10,000 cash award. As Leland Stanford, the founder of Stanford University, said, "We do not believe that there can be superfluous education, as man cannot have too much health or too much intelligence, so he cannot be too highly educated." In that spirit, Polaroid is proud that Dr. Land's legacy will live through the establishment of the Edwin H. Land Endowment Fund. Now I would like to introduce Calvo Lottridge, Executive Director of the Society for Imaging Science and Technology, and John Howard, President of the Optical Society.
Edwin Land presented much of his work over the years in the conferences and journals of two societies, the Society for Imaging Science and Technology. In those days, we were SPSE, the Society of Photographic Scientists and Engineers, and in the Optical Society of America. Now these two societies, OSA and IS&T, will share jointly in the Edwin Land Medal. Since it has just been announced, many of the details are yet to be worked out. What we do know is that this medal will honor the contributions of an extraordinary man who gave much to the science and technology of imaging. Speaking for the board of directors and for the members of IS&T, I want to express our gratitude to Polaroid for the endowment which makes this possible. John Howard.
The Optical Society of America is happy to serve as a co-sponsor of the Edwin Land Medal. Dr. Land was one of OSA's seven honorary members and had himself won OSA's highest award for outstanding scientific achievement. Just as a particular point of pride, I would like to mention that when Dr. Land was ready to announce to the world his instant camera in February 1947, he did this at an Optical Society meeting. We look forward to the implementation of the Edwin Land Medal, and we are grateful to Polaroid for making this Edwin Land Medal possible.
Edwin Land was a scientist for the ages. A man with infinite capacity for invention, a charismatic leader, a pioneering businessman, and a visionary who dreamed remarkable dreams. One way to capture the essence of Dr. Land is through our memories, through our laughter, through our tears. Another way is through his very own words. This will help us see the full picture of this extraordinary man. Here, then, are Dr. Land's own words, presented by one of the most distinguished journalists of our time, noted CBS correspondent, news anchor, and author, Charles Osgood.
Good evening. The poet Carl Sandburg once said, "Nothing happens unless first the dream." Edwin H. Land was a man with a dream, and he never tired of speaking the dream or attempting to turn a dream into reality. In fact, it was his life's work. We've come together tonight to share a mosaic of our memories of this man. And here at the end of the program, we're going to hear in his own words some of the things that Dr. Land thought about and wrote about and spoke of. Land on land. It's as though he's getting the last word here. And I suppose there's nothing unusual or new about that. Here he is, reflecting on the years of his first great dream, the artificial polarizer. At the time, there was nobody on Earth who thought an artificial polarizer was as important as did this young man from Massachusetts. He was 17. The secret that we had then was in knowing that if you dream of something worth doing, and then simply go to work on it and don't think anything of personalities or emotional conflicts or of money or of family distractions, if you just think detail by detail of what you have to do next, it's a wonderful dream, even though the end is a long way off. This was a mindset that would serve him well through the thousands of hours that he would spend alone and with his colleagues trying to figure something out. If there are 5,000 steps to be taken, he said, you start taking the first 10 and the 20 after that. And it is amazing how quickly you get through 4,990. The last 10 steps you never seem to work out, but you keep coming nearer to giving the world something. When he moved to a basement room in Manhattan and walked to the New York Public Library each day, he was determined to read everything that was known about polarized light. This was not a dream. This was a clear plan that could positively be fulfilled. And he did it. Each day he walked between the two stone lions that guard the entrance to the library. It is not known whether he actually knew the names of those two lions, but he probably did. But to use Henry James's phrase, Land was a person on whom nothing was lost. The lions were named Fortitude and Patience, two words that could easily be used to describe Edwin Land, two among many. He had many sides, many facets, and he seemed to like it that way. That may be why this serious man often smiled with what has been called a little boy's smile. On the one hand, he was impatient, always anxious to move things along, to move an idea along, to move a person along, to move the company along. On the other hand, he had the patience of a dedicated scientist. He put it this way. When I started the actual program of making the black and white film for our camera, I set down the broad principles that would also apply to color. I invited Howard Rogers to sit opposite me in the black and white lab and think about color. For many months, he simply sat and assimilated the techniques we were using in black and white. And then, one day, he stood up and said, "I am ready to start now." My point is that we created an environment in which a man was expected to sit and think for 2 years. Dr. Land had a big supply of aphorisms ready at hand, sort of thoughtful one-liners. Any problem can be solved using the materials in the room. If you can state a problem and it is important enough, then that problem can be solved. We have all the answers. We just haven't asked the questions yet. Now, to some, these thoughts may seem improbable, but Land was a teacher at heart, and he liked anything, any idea that would jiggle the mind of the listener, would open it up to something new. There was always the possibility that you might, at some point, make the improbable come true. In the same way, he was a great fan of unexpectedness, and he knew that you had to pay attention so that the unexpected moment would not get away from you. The great architect, Lewis Sullivan, said once that to pay attention is to live, and to live is to pay attention. That was an idea right up Dr. Land's alley. And when he paid attention to his daughter's unexpected question, "Why can't I see the pictures now?" he changed photography forever. Listen to him, remembering that day in Santa Fe so long ago. As I walked around that charming town, I undertook the task of solving the puzzle she had set me. Within the hour, the camera, the film, and the physical chemistry had become so clear to me that I hurried over to where David Brown, our patent attorney, happened to be staying to describe to him in great detail a dry camera which would give a picture immediately after exposure. In my mind, it was so real and complete that I spent several hours describing it. And then, as he worked with his colleagues for 3 years to create the first working model of the camera, something else became clear to Land. It was as if all that we had done in learning to make polarizers, the knowledge of plastics, the properties of viscous liquids, The preparation of microscopic crystals smaller than the wavelength of light. The laminating of plastic sheets. The living in a world of colloids in supersaturated solutions. All this had been a school and a preparation for that first day in which I suddenly knew how to make a one-step photographic process, and for the following 3 years in which we made the very vivid dream into a solid reality. Edwin Land had worked for many years on a vast array of solutions, and in the end, he found out what they were the solutions to. Like Thomas Jefferson, Land's faith in the power of education was unbounded. He was never embarrassed to speak a dream, no matter how fragile or unformed it might be. Just listen. My fantasy is this, that we can now use the industrial system at the same time we are making cameras, that we can use the system for another thing, and that is to find out what's inside of your heads and hearts, to find out how to make each one of you an individual, and to find a channel and a niche for the fulfillment of your personal growth. I know, for example, that if I could take a group of you off to my laboratory, in 6 months, I could have you working on some research problems that you would find just amazing. And at the end of that time, the people in that group would find that they had resources that they had not dreamed they had, that they were doing things that they did not know that they could do, and that they had a deeper self-respect and excitement when they came to work, and that at the end of the week, they would look back to a great success. He wanted to build worthwhile projects, things that nobody else could build, and he continued to work all through his life to create the ideal workplace. It was perhaps easier to dream in the laboratory, because there the dreams were much more manageable and controllable. A chemical always reacts the same way. The reactions of people are less predictable. And yet, Land was not daunted by the unpredictability of the human mind and heart. He kept right on speaking the workplace dream, complicated, though it always was. It seems to me, he wrote, that the role of industry, the new role of industry, should be for us to sit down together and say, industry is the place in which we can pick projects so exciting and important and delightful and significant that every day when we wake up, we will know that we are going to go in to be an intelligent, productive part of an activity that we do not have to justify. We know that while we are with our company, we will have emotions and furies and urges and angers and delights. We will channel those emotions to help each other. At the same time, we are criticizing each other. So that when we go home at night, we will say, however complicated and unpredictable life may be, we have a sense of direction and a feeling that we have identified ourselves with some long-term, maybe mystic purposes, with something the human animal likes most, and that is a feeling of progress. A feeling that some tremendous intuitive need to create has been satisfied in a way in which we could not have satisfied it in our individual life, but which we can satisfy if we work together. Not many leading American industrialists talk that way. Dreaming, creating, and organizing. Throughout a lifetime, Edwin Land was immensely successful. But he never forgot about the importance of failure. In the physical sciences, when you work in the lab, you fail, 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 fail. When you have failed enough times, you have a 3,000 speed film. The secret of science is that it has learned to fail without emotion and embarrassment. It is the technique of failure without emotion, the use of failure as a method of learning that has made science. But in experimentation in the social sciences, we are always guilty about failure. And we must get used to the idea that we are going to have 1,000 failures. We are going to try and fail and try and fail and learn as we go along, so that at the end of a year or two, we will look back and to our amazement find out that each of you have some talents that we did not know you had. You learned some things we did not know you could learn. You made some things we did not know you could make. Your mind and your body turn out to be the acquisitions of great powers. Edwin H. Land, scientist, inventor, industrialist, and philosopher. He liked to lead without seeming to lead, to be on hand but still be off to the side, to be omnipresent and yet somehow invisible. He was a shy man who always wound up center stage. But these divergent feelings always vanished when the moment arrived for zest or curiosity or drive or enthusiasm or passion or for speaking the dream. Thornton Wilder wrote that a person does not really die until every person who knew him also dies. This evening seems to confirm that idea. Dr. Land has been living as vividly in memory as he did in life itself. In St. Paul's Cathedral in London is the crypt of the great English architect, Sir Christopher Wren. He designed that monumental structure. On the side of the crypt, it says in Latin, "If you would seek his monument, look about you." Perhaps at this gathering, we can say the same thing about Dr. Land. If you would seek his monument, look about you. What you see is not the Polaroid Corporation with its multi-billion dollar investments in buildings and equipment, or the company's unique history, which stretches back more than a half a century. What you see are the people who are Polaroid today, the people who are taking it into tomorrow. I think Edwin Land, who was always inordinately interested in tomorrow, would be very happy with such a living and lively monument. Thank you.
Mortals, join the mighty chorus which the morning stars began. Father, love is reigning o'er us. Brother, love binds man to man. Ever singing, march we onward, victors in the midst of strife. Joyful music lifts us onward in the triumph song of life. Ever singing, march we onward, victors in the midst of strife. Joyful music lifts us onward in the triumph song of life. Mortals, join the mighty chorus which the morning stars began. Father, love is reigning o'er us. Brother, love binds man to man. Ever singing, march we onward, victors in the midst of strife. Joyful music lifts us onward in the triumph song of life. Ever singing, march we onward, victors in the midst of strife. Joyful music lifts us onward in the triumph song of life.
Those of us who knew Edwin H. Land are fortunate indeed. Few people on earth ever reach his stature. To have walked and talked with such a man, to have worked with him, laughed with him, and shared parts of our lives with him was a rare privilege indeed. All of us at Polaroid, those who knew him and those who did not, are privileged in another way as well. We're the ones who are honored to carry on his legacy into the future and to keep dreaming his dreams as we dream our own. He's gone from us physically, but he lives on in our memories and our hearts, as he always has, bigger than life. Have a good evening and a safe trip home. Thank you. Thank you.